you, I. Tonight, we are quenching our thirst at the bar with a show all about quaffing. Chin chin, it's Joe Brand. Mine's a large one, Phill Jupitus. Three sheets to the wind, it's Prue Leith. Would you mind stepping out of the vehicle, please, sir? It's Alan Davis. Right, the buzzers are on the house, so what can I get you? Prue goes... Pina coladas. Phill goes... Pina. Joe goes... Alan goes. I am the cider drink. As soon as all my troubles away. Right. When might it be a good idea to order 300 gin and tonics?
Tuesday.
A bit late in the week, frankly, to be doing it. Let's think it through. What is in gin and tonic?
Quinine.
Quinine is in. And why might you want quinine?
Isn't it good for stopping mosquitoes biting you?
No, it doesn't stop mosquitoes biting you, but it used to be the treatment for...
Malaria.
For malaria, yeah. So the problem is that today's tonic contains very little. So in order for it to be effective, you would really have to drink 300 gin and tonics every single day.
I accept that prescription.
I mean, don't try it, because too much quinine is unbelievably bad for you. You can get abnormal heart rhythms, you can get double vision. I think that's the gin, actually, if I'm honest with you.
Like, I haven't got an abnormal heart rhythm already. No, yeah. Seriously, it's like a jazz band.
Yeah. I don't even know what quinine is, do you?
It comes from the bark of the cinchona tree.
Oh.
So the...
That's quite interesting.
Thank you, darling. I'm working my ass off here, so thank you for that. So the Quechua people, who were the indigenous people of South America, they knew about it long before the Europeans.
Because they lived there.
Because they lived there, exactly.
The Europeans are at a massive disadvantage with the fauna of South America.
Yeah.
And the flora.
But the really sad thing is that it was the Europeans who brought malaria to them. So the malaria did not exist.
Oh, and now we have to go there to catch it. Very, very odd, isn't it? So what, do you get it out the bark and what?
Yeah, so you have to distill it. You have to distill
it from the bark.
Oil
it up and then drip it out? Or how do you do that even?
Well, it's a very long chemical process and it was first done in 1820 by two French scientists. But it changed the face of the world. Why might that be?
You could just go to more horrible places.
Well, you could go to places that you wanted to colonise.
Yeah. Paint the whole map pink.
Exactly right, Prue. You could suddenly go to India and parts of Africa.
Give them gonorrhea instead.
Yeah. Give us your land, we'll give you an itch in an uncomfortable place. There you go. But the pre-quinine malaria treatments, they were just as bizarre as they were desperate. So I love this one. In medieval Europe, it was thought that it would work if you were thrown headfirst into a bush. And if you got out quickly enough to leave the fever behind, that would sort you out.
God, if someone landed in my bush trying to...
Not leaving your fever there.
Get out of it. Also, eat an onion with Amen written on it. Is it good for you, Prue, to eat a raw onion? I would have thought.
My mother used to have onion sandwiches, raw onion sandwiches, white bread, lots of butter, raw onions. It's delicious.
Tell her to put some cheese in. Lovely.
Right, that's your G&T. Now time for some shots. So you've all got a shot glass of something beside you. So, Alan, having a look at yours, what do you think it might be?
Do you want me to drink it?
You have a taste, yes, have a taste.
A taste?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, is it... If I drank it all, would I die?
No, I'm not allowed to kill you.
Sounds to me like you've said that before.
I have to say the contract this year has been particularly tricky to negotiate. What's it taste of?
I just drank that. I've got no idea what it is.
Any thoughts of what it tastes of?
It tastes... I'm getting...
I'm getting gravel from the A1
side of a wardrobe. It hasn't been opened in a couple of years.
It's as close as we can get to what the gladiators used to drink. So they quaffed a drink which was made from ash, vinegar and water in order to help Are you enjoying it more or less now?
Basically, what you're drinking there is a burnt down chip shop.
Getting Savaloy's.
What we know is the gladiators were mostly vegetarian. They had a diet of lots of lentils and lots of beans. We know this from QI's great friend Pliny the Elder. I have to say, things he wrote, we have to take them with a little bit of a pinch of salt, because he also said, drinking bull's blood cures snake bites and turnips provoke lust.
I can't argue with that.
Yeah. These are kind of early energy drinks. And the nearest we can find to the kind of ash thing is activated charcoal shots. And people do drink them now, and adherents say it's fantastic for, I don't know, hangovers, increasing your energy. I have to warn you that it can cause constipation and make your poo black.
Just no change there.
OK, so a little bit of ash for you. Let's come on to Phil. Mm. So, charioteers...
I'm straight away malt vinegar right out of the trap.
OK.
Some malt vinegar. It tastes like watered down malt vinegar, but I'm getting a bit of a salty back end on it.
Yeah, so, well.
I think you said that before as well.
Had we been able to do this properly, a salty back end is exactly what's missing, because what they drank was indeed vinegar, which had been watered down, but it also had dung in it, which would be. Would be your sorted down back end right there.
So what is in?
This is just Posca, which is vinegar and water. It would have lots of good calories in it. It would have been a perfectly healthy thing, good for your gut and so on. Even Nero, who fancied himself as a charioteer, he swore by a good old draught of pig dung and vinegar to help you with your recovery. Did you like it?
No.
No. Right, Joe, let's have a go with you.
Looks like liquid hopelessness to me.
Do you like it?
It tastes like ginger beer.
It is just ginger, my darling. It's a stimulant. Ginger, wherever it's been available, has been used, has it not, as a medicine. Here's the thing. If you drank that, how would you feel about drinking from a toilet bowl?
Love it.
Well, one of the weirdest things about drinking ginger is apparently it suppresses feelings of disgust. So they did a study in 2019 in the Journal of the American Psychological Association.
Maybe I'll have sex with my husband tonight.
You see your wife having a ginger ale before bed. Oh, I see. I understand. I'll just get me back.
So mildly disgusting things like snot in a napkin or something, you would feel... Yeah,
have that on some toast.
If you have that, if you have the ginger first, apparently you don't feel as disgusted. Somehow the ginger suppresses the disgust.
Quite like the concept of snot on a napkin, though. That sounds like an upmarket restaurant.
It's like a cocktail. And have a snot on a napkin.
All right, Prue, let's have a go.
You better have a ginger ale first.
What can you smell?
I gave it a sniff to see that professional.
Oh, yes.
I have no idea what this is, but I have drunk it before.
What's that? It's a modern energy drink. You don't like the taste of it?
Well, it's a bit sweet. What's well, it made
it's crack.
Sugar and caffeine and something called taurine, which is supposed to be even more stimulating than caffeine. They're pretty much all those.
So if I have it all, I'll be...
High as a kite, darling, high as a kite. So these are all energy drinks from a long time ago. This is the most modern one that we've come to here. The money made by it is more than the fragrance and cannabis market combined. It is worth an absolute fortune.
And since it's absolutely stuffed full of sugar...
Yeah.
..all it's doing is making you fat.
Your point being.
Right, drinks away, please. Time to go from quaffing to scoffing, but we are staying with the letter Q. Can you name a cereal crop that begins with a Q? Pina colada. Yes!
Quaker oats.
Quaker oats is as close as we were able to find ourselves. You are exactly right. You get extra points.
It's not quinoa, because I think quinoa isn't a grass.
It is not a grain, it's a seed.
It's a seed.
Mammal. It's a seed. Yeah, that's a mammal. It's a seed, so strictly speaking, it cannot be classified as a cereal. And in fact, you know, it's good news for the Ashkenazi Jews, for example. They're not allowed to eat grains over Passover, whereas they can eat quinoa.
Bad luck to them. It tastes shit.
I always think it's one of those foods that you need to add actual food to it to make it taste
like
of anything.
Yeah, like a cake.
Yeah.
Have quinoa.
Of course, I've had quinoa.
Of course, he has. Do you like it?
No. It's annoying on your plate. It's annoying in your mouth. It's irritating stuff.
Have you cooked with it, Prue?
Yeah, of course I've cooked with it.
You like it?
Yeah, I like it, but I agree with you. It needs help.
Here's the thing about quinoa. It's a superfood. It contains a lot more protein than most plants, plenty of iron, high in vitamin E. It also has all 10 amino acids needed to support human life. I mean, I say this in fairness. Haribo contains 9 of the so-called
I really
blocks.
Want to believe that.
That is true. Haribo has 9 of the building blocks
right.
of life.
Haribo Day keeps the doctor away.
Now, seeing as we have Prue on the panel, I thought I should test your baking skills, the rest of you. So we're going to make some Danish lemon quaffles. And Prue, I'm going to ask you to judge, please. So everybody bring out your tray with your ingredients. So Prue, that is the instructions. Have you made Danish lemon quaffles before, Prue?
I don't think they exist.
Don't be ridiculous. Okay, here we go. Right, you've got 1 egg, 1/2 cup of buttermilk, 5 teaspoons of baking soda, 1/2 teaspoon of vanilla, 1 cup of lemon juice, 1 1/4 cups of sugar, 7/8 cup of all-purpose flour and 8 tablespoons of melted butter. Prue, what are the instructions, please?
All right, in a small bowl, beat the egg until foamy.
The egg's foamy or until you're foamy?
No, you've got to beat it up.
Until it's foamy.
Come on, foam up, you bastard!
That looks foamy, what do you reckon?
Is that foamy?
OK, now.
Yeah?
All right.
Put it in a pan and get the beans warmed up.
No, no. Add the buttermilk and vanilla.
One's the buttermilk?
That's the white one.
Ooh, it's gloopy.
And blended well.
Yeah, so, and the vanilla,
Is that
darling?
The vanilla?
That's vanilla.
I was hoping that was a shot of Glenfiddich.
Sandy! Are available. Sandy!
Yeah?
Can I lick the bowl, Sandy?
Not a minute. We've got a bit more work to do.
Add the baking soda, 1 teaspoon at a time. Sprinkling it and beating until the mixture is smooth and the consistency of light cream.
Alan, you can do this, right? And beating.
Sandy, you should keep that other show where it belongs.
There's your teaspoon. Let me help you.
Thank you.
There we go. Sprinkling it in.
How much baking soda? The whole lot.
All of it. Let's get.
Okay.
That's cheeky.
Thankfully, there's some skills I had as a young man that are becoming useful.
Okay. I'm working at Baker's!
Listen.
Right, now what?
I used to charge a fiver for this.
Now,
you had to have the right money.
There was a queue round the block. Okay, so I've done that.
Yep.
Pour the mixture into the beaker.
Oh, a beaker, is it? Mm.
Okay, pour that in there.
Ah!
It's
going to be awesome. We don't want to go in the beaker! Go in the beaker! Go in the beaker! No, we want to be back in our individual bowl!
Okay.
Do you ever cook with your children?
Everybody! They like the process, but they won't eat anything.
Okay, add the lemon juice all at once and blend into the mixture.
Blend? How do you... Oh, no, I spilt some in the egg cup. Great.
That was fab, wasn't
was really
it?
Good.
It was
what?
Fab.
Oh.
Is that real food?
No, darling.
This is bullshit!
Phil, you've still got a cup of sugar.
anybody know why why that happened.
Something to do with the acid.
I think it happened because Prue doesn't know how to cook.
So the lemon juice is acid and it mixes with baking powder, which is a carbonate, and that is what happens. Obviously, we invented Danish lemon quaffles because it begins with a Q. Can I recommend to you a Penn and Teller book called How to Play With Your Food, and the recipe's in there. It's called Swedish Lemon Angels. But what a great thing to make with your kids, and wasn't Prue fantastic getting out the instructions there? baking on television. It'll never catch on. Now for a question on quips. Phil, how many jokes would you exchange for this person?
Well, it's my child, so... I've got to be honest, it's a buyer's market.
So this is your daughter, Emily.
Yeah.
And Emily is now one of the elves here. She works for us on QI. But we learnt this wonderful thing in between the 5th and the 2nd century BC in Athens. Comedians were known as parasitos. Literally means...
We still are.
Literally means parasites.
Yeah.
So spongers. And they made a living by turning up at dinner parties uninvited and they would exchange jokes for food. And they had their own joke books and kept them updated.
That's why we're such brilliant comics. Look at the size of us.
Exactly.
One or two dinners.
Yeah.
So there was a parasitos called Soturio and he kept a whole chest full of joke books at home and he offered up 600 of his quips, his jokes, as a dowry for his daughter. So we thought, well, let's extend this and let's have your daughter as a hostage and see how many jokes you would exchange. So okay. If you can make the audience laugh, I will release her.
OK. A salesman knocks on the door of a house and the door opens and there's a 5-year-old child standing there with a cigar and a balloon of brandy. And the salesman looks at the little boy and goes, "Hello, little boy." He goes, "All right." He goes, "Are your mum and dad in?" And he goes, "Does it look like they are?"
OK, release the child. So the ancient Greeks had stand-up comedy nights, but a lot of the time only other comedians would attend. There was a group in...
What's the one on the right doing to the one on the right?
I believe that's the beginning of improv.
The one on the left's not keen on it. Second left's going, "Look at him, look at him!" "Look at him or I will torture you!"
Anyway, there used to be a thing called the Group of 60, and they were Athenian wits who got together and exchanged jokes. And so one of the ways you would tell a joke in Athens, you would say, "The 60 said," and so on. But the very first joke book that Europe ever had was published by... Anybody have a guess? We are talking in the mid-1400s.
Ladybird.
Well... The Vatican published. It was utterly obscene. They had a sort of joke club called the Bugiali. It was literally a fib factory. There was a papal secretary called Poggio Bracciolini, and he kept a record of all these jokes. And he published it, 273 puns and jokes, mostly the usual stuff, farts, erections, obesity...
Rubbish at reading, isn't he? Look at him.
Yeah.
"Excuse me, is that Athena? The frame of my picture has fallen on my head."
Right, now, what was the most exciting diet in history?
I reckon in the Siege of Paris.
Oh!
They ate the zoo animals.
They did, darling. 1870, there were recipes for elephant.
Elephant. There were recipes for his trunk and his, whatever you call it.
Yeah?
Cock.
I believe some roosters were eaten as well. So that is an interesting one, but it's possibly not the most...
Exciting.
Exciting diet. At the end of the 19th and indeed the beginning of the 20th century, there were professional fasters. They were called hunger artists. And these were people who would, in public, see who could fast for the longest.
I'd love to do that, wouldn't you?
Yeah. If we all stopped eating now, if we like didn't have any food, the five of us, would me and Joe last longer because we're fat?
How dare you!
I point out I'm much heavier than Joe. I'll slaughter her in a fasting competition.
It's not a competition, but do
I think
these reserves?
Yes, of course we would last longer.
Do you?
Yeah.
Don't you think?
I don't know that's necessarily true. I think it depends on your metabolism and your ability to survive.
Yeah.
So how long do you think you would last? Because if you could last for a very long time, you could make thousands and thousands of pounds.
A year.
There was a guy called Giovanni Succi. He was paid more than £250,000 back in 1890. He lasted 40 days on stage in London.
And afterwards, he had missed eating so much, he went on to found Pringles.
What we now reckon is, doesn't matter about your initial body weight, you probably lost 8 to 12 weeks.
OK.
All of us would be about the same. But this fad, it started in 1880. There was a doctor called Henry Tanner, and he bet that he could live on water for 40 days, and he made an absolute fortune from people just coming to stare at him. There was a woman called Molly Flancher. She was also known as the Brooklyn Enigma, and she claimed she had psychic abilities due to starvation, and she was challenged to do it for 40 days with round-the-clock observation by doctors, but she said, the doctors are bound to be male, I'm not going to do it. Because, you know, modesty would prevent me from doing this. The truth is, on the whole, it was discovered people had been secretly eating. Anybody remember the last one in sort of in popular...
Oh, it's David Blaine.
David
in
Blaine.
The box.
Yeah, he did 44 days in the box.
I went to see him. Did you go and see him? When I went, it was quite late at night and people were throwing eggs at him, which I thought was rude.
How long would you last if you just... without water, though?
Not anywhere near as long. I mean, you must have
3 days.
You must have some hydration of some kind. There's a rule of three. You can survive 3 hours without shelter, you can survive 3 days without water, and 3 weeks without food is the sort of rule of three.
What was the first one?
You can survive 3 hours without shelter.
This cricket match is longer than that.
I mean, the one that is extraordinary is the breatharian diet. Does anybody know what the breatharian diet is?
Is it breathing air?
Just that. Literally just that. They claim to live purely off light and air. I would guess they're the only people who can bore vegans at dinner parties. What's the least amount of food anything can survive on?
Any human?
No, anything. A living being.
2% of your body weight or something?
2% of your body weight? I mean, we need at least 1,200 calories, don't we, the human beings?
Only 1,200?
That's three muffins.
A team from the University of Southern California has recently discovered microbes that genuinely seem to survive on almost nothing. This is an astonishing story. So, the sediments of the Pacific Ocean, they have been found living there, and based on how much oxygen has depleted over the ages, researchers propose that they may have been alive for 75 million years. They've certainly been alive for an extraordinarily long period of time. They don't do anything apart from really, really slowly metabolizing really, really small amounts of food. What is extraordinary, so say they've been alive for 75 million years, that time, if they can understand time, will have passed really quickly for them, because an animal's ability to perceive time is linked to the speed of its metabolism. So a fly has very, very fast metabolism, so signals go to the brain incredibly quickly, so a newspaper coming at it seems to move rather slowly, and that means that the fly can get away much more quickly.
You never can swat them.
You've got a couple of 75 million year old microbes at the bottom of the Pacific going, where have the dinosaurs gone?
Yeah. it is the last.
There is 10 minutes to go.
Also, are they not going, well, he's evolved, she's evolved, they all evolved. He's gone on land now. Oh. That one. Here we are, still at the starting gate. What's going wrong with us?
Do you remember that comet?
Which one?
What about that asteroid? That was a bang.
Oh,
wasn't it?
It's big, wasn't it?
Anyway, 75 million. Isn't that astonishing?
Yeah, brilliant.
Right. Now it's time for the round that's guaranteed to make Alan's stomach turn. General ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What is the most expensive liquid on Earth?
It's probably a wine.
Yeah, anybody else?
Elvis's bathwater. There's someone doing little vials of beetle.
No.
Yeah.
Really?
Go online, have a look.
And people are buying
little
it.
Little vials of bathwater.
Yeah, because when he died, everybody went, oh, I know, save the bathwater.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I thought he died on the toilet.
Yeah, that's much cheaper, that water.
We think the answer is probably racehorse semen. There is an internet factoid that says scorpion venom is the most expensive liquid on Earth. It is 30 million pounds per gallon. But here's the thing about scientists. They've worked out a new way of breeding and milking scorpions. It's brought the price right down. Oh, yes.
Oh, they've ruined the market's crash.
I know. You can now get a gallon of scorpion venom for a mere £70,000.
Now, come on, Daisy, put your stinger in the milker.
Yeah. gallon is a lot.
It is a lot. You can get a gallon of LSD for
£123,000. It's on off Waitrose.
Chanel number 5, £20,000 per gallon. Printer ink, £2,000 per gallon. So we're heading down the prices
Holy
here.
Shit, that is a racket, isn't
that
it?
That is a racket. But the most expensive liquid that we can find seems to be racehorse semen. So, for a mare to be serviced by a famous thoroughbred called Galileo would cost the owner about £540,000. The average volume of a stallion's ejaculation is 65 mil. So, Galileo would have to ejaculate 70 times in order to produce 1 gallon of semen, and so his semen would be worth almost £50 million per gallon. It is the most expensive thing.
Wow!
I know.
How much is a man's semen worth?
Yours, a quid.
Yeah.
What, a gallon? In Poundland.
Horse semen is much more expensive than printer ink, but even if it was cheaper, it would probably cause some kind of paper jam. Now, what is traditional marmalade made from?
Quinces?
Oranges.
Prue had it right. What did you say?
Quince.
It is. So, etymologically speaking, marmalade should be made from quince. Anybody know where we get the word marmalade from?
Well, the myth is it's Marie Malade, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mary Queen of Scots.
That Mary Queen of Scots supposedly ate it when she was sick, and it was the French, she is sick, and so they made the marmalade. It's an absolute nonsense. It comes from an old word for quince. It's Portuguese marmelo. Joe, why might you not want to be a marmalade madam?
Is that not fruit?
What do you reckon, marmalade madam?
You run a brothel and you
yes.
get paid in jam for your hookers.
Well, you don't run the brothel, you are a prostitute. It was a 17th, 18th century.
You have to make them toast afterwards.
The young ladies of the night were known as marmalade madam.
I used to live next to a madam of a brothel. She used to tell me which news readers used to come in. They're not telling you. Oh, yeah.
Did one of them, just before he finished, go, and finally?
No.
This just in.
And now showers. Oh, my God, I'm joining in. Which brings us to the belly of the beast, the scores. Let's have a quick... Oh, this is very good. In first place, absolutely marmalising the competition with 6 points, it's Phil!
Not a real quiz. This is not a real quiz.
In second place with 2 points, it's Alan! And in penultimate place, making a fantastic debut with minus one, Prue! Busting a gut, yet still in last place with minus 13. Joe! My thanks to Prue, Phil, Joe and Alan, and it's time, ladies and gentlemen, please, with this quaffing quotation from Terry Pratchett. There are better things in the world than alcohol, but alcohol sort of compensates for not getting them. Cheers.